Television's first decade was the era of live TV. Most original programming was broadcast when it was produced. This was not by choice. No satisfactory recording method except photographic film was available. Many live shows actually were televised twice for different time zones. It was possible to make a record of a show, a film shot from a studio monitor called a kinescope recording. These recordings were often used by stations beyond the reach of cable or microwave interconnections from the networks. Now, because kinescope recordings were expensive and of poor quality, almost from the start of television, engineers tried to search for a way to record video on magnetic tape. Audio tape recordings were widely used on radio, and tape recorders were becoming popular on the consumer market. It was logical that the signals representing audio could be stored on tape, their video counterparts also could be recorded. The problem was that the video signal was far more complex, and the frequencies involved were much higher than in audio. We've got a real problem when we try to record full-blown video using a method similar to what we do with audio. Basic physics states that the highest frequency you can record on a magnetic tape is determined by two things. One is how fast a tape travels by the head, and the other is how narrow the head gap is, that is, the space between the two poles on a recording head. The maximum frequency you can record is equal to the velocity of the tape as it passes by the head, divided by twice the width of the tape's head gap. In audio, the highest frequency that has to be recorded is about 20,000 cycles per second. This means that, at 15 inches per second tape speed, you'll need a head gap of about 0.000375 of an inch. This was totally manageable in the 1950s and made for excellent quality audio recordings. In fact, head gaps could be made as small as 1/16,000th of an inch across, meaning audio recordings as low as 3¾ inches per second sounded fine. The video signal has frequencies up to 4.2 million cycles per second in it. Using our now well-worn formula, we plug in the numbers and come up with a tape speed of 504 inches per second. A half-hour recording at this speed would require 75,600 feet of videotape. That's a little more than 14 miles. This isn't going to work. The breakthrough finally came in 1956 from Ampex. They solved the problem by mounting the recording heads on a drum that revolved at high speed, 14,400 RPM, impressing the signal crosswise on the tape, while the tape itself moved at a relatively slow pace. This was the quad, so called because of its use of four recording heads. It used tape 2 inches wide. Here's a little nitty-gritty on what the guys at Ampex designed into their machine. In 1 second, the head drum rotates 240 times, placing 960 short tracks on the videotape. The tape is 2 inches wide, but room is left for audio, control track, and blank separating guard bands. Therefore, each video track is about 1 4/5 inches long. To allow uninterrupted output from the switched heads, only 1 5/8 inches is used for fresh video. The rest is overlap. If we do the math on the Ampex system, we find out that the effective tape to head speed is 1,560 inches per second, 960 tracks per second, each one being 1 5/8 inches long. Using our familiar formula, this means that we can record a frequency of up to 13 megahertz. Lots of room for our 4.2 megahertz video signal. It's not quite that simple, however. The next problem is one of the strength of a signal relative to its frequency. If we try to record a full response signal directly on tape, we find that the higher the frequency of a recorded signal, the greater the playback output from the tape. Conversely, the lower the frequency, the lower the playback output. This causes us grief because we're trying to put on videotape a signal between 30 Hz and 4.2 million Hz. That's a 140,000:1 ratio. And that, in turn, means the playback voltage at 30 Hz will be 1/140,000th as strong as that at 4.2 megahertz. Expressed as dB, like we do in audio, this ends up being a range from lowest to highest of about 103 dB. This is not good. What to do? Using a super equalizer to hold down the higher frequencies, thereby making the frequencies more even to one another, is one idea. Unfortunately, even today, let alone in 1956, most amplifiers and equalizers have electronic noise in them below about 60 dB. That's still a long way from our 103 dB required range. With this method, all of our low frequencies would be hopelessly lost in the noise. The solution lies in a thing we call a modulator. Remember that a modulator is a sort of valve. One signal, called a carrier, is sent into the modulator. A second signal, the modulating one, varies a parameter of the carrier, either its level or amplitude, or its otherwise constant frequency. The output is either amplitude modulation or a frequency modulation of the input signal, known as AM and FM to most radio listeners. What we're going to use to solve our problem is frequency modulation. A carrier of 8.6 MHz is modulated by the incoming video, which may be up to 4.2 MHz. The modulator output will vary between 4.2 MHz and 12.8 MHz. Within these fluctuations is a replica of the program video. What's important to us is the ratio of the highest to lowest frequencies on the tape. That's now about 3:1. This is a little less than the 10 dB difference. Any noise in our electronic amplifiers will be way back at minus 60 dB, an excellent safety margin. Now, to use this modulated system, we'll need to be able to record about 13 MHz of information on our VTR. With the quad system and its effective head-to-tape speed of 1,560 inches per second, we have that recording capacity. The demodulator has the reverse function of the modulator. It takes the high-frequency signal from the tape and retrieves the video from it. This sort of fundamental video signal is then put various processing circuitry to make it stable again and to adjust its levels, at which point it is just like any other video source. Of course, it's more complicated than that. We've glossed over all kinds of things like servos and time-based correctors. When a videotape is recorded, there must be a way of letting the videotape recorder later on know just when and where the video tracks are laid down, so that they may be played back reliably. In addition, the motor spinning our rotating video heads, the head drum motor, and the motor actually pulling the tape through the transport, the capstan motor, must be kept running at a very constant identifiable speed, reference to the incoming video. We do it with a servo. A servo, in general terms, is an automatic control mechanism in which the output of a device is compared to a stable input reference, so corrections can be made. Consider the following predicament. You've been chosen to keep the speed of a fan motor constant. To do that, we supplied you with some equipment, a knob to speed up and slow down the fan, and a little counter that's attached to the fan motor shaft. Every second, the counter resets itself and starts counting the revolutions of the fan motor. Your job is to keep the counter always at 100 counts per second, no more, no less. In the first second, the counter counts up to 102. You turn the speed control down a little bit to slow down the fan. In the next second, the counter only counts up to 97. You went too far. You turn up the knob a little bit. In the next second, the counter is up to 99. You turn it up a tiny bit more. The subsequent count says you're at 101. You back off the knob a little bit. And so on. You're a servo. You're continually comparing the speed of the fan to a constant, 100, and adjusting the speed to try and match it. Now get rid of the knob, the little electronic counter, and your hand, and do it electronically. That's an electronic servo. The drum servo is trying to keep a constant speed for the video heads as they go across the videotape. During record, it looks at the incoming video's horizontal sync pulses and ensures that the quad VTR lays down 32 video tracks for each frame of video. Each track has a little more than 16 video lines recorded onto it. During playback, the drum servo looks at an external reference from a central sync generator within the broadcast facility and ensures that it plays back the correct 32 video tracks to reproduce one full frame of video in time with the rest of the station's video sources. The capstan servo, on the other hand, is trying to ensure that the tape is being pulled through the videotape recorder at a very constant speed. During record, the capstan motor runs at a certain speed, which is compared to the timing of the incoming video's vertical sync pulses. While this is going on, a control track is being laid down on the videotape by the control track head. This is a pulse for every frame of video, about 30 pulses a second. On playback, the capstan servo looks at the control track and makes sure that the tape is being played back at exactly the right speed, reference to the station's external vertical sync pulses. The control track signal is also a basis for setting up the tape's position, relative to the video head's ability to pick up the tracks recorded on the tape. The speed is adjusted during the lockup period, just after pressing the play button, so the video tracks line up precisely with the video heads sweeping by. This process is known as tracking, and it usually takes a couple of seconds to take hold. That's why, when you push play on the VTR, the picture is a little unstable for a couple of seconds. The VTR servos are getting their act together. And that's why, in a production environment, we roll a VTR a few seconds before we need to take it to air. All VTRs are mechanical devices, and there is a limit to the timing accuracy on playback that can be achieved. The limit is set by the mechanical accuracy of head wheel bearings and motors, a certain minimum variation in tape quality along the length and width of the tape. Also, gradual and sudden variations of tape guide adjustment and tape path during extended use may cause variations.
The first quad VTRs had two devices within them. The Amtec, which stood for Ampex Tape Error Corrector, was the first analog time-based corrector. And it was essentially a series of electronically variable delay lines used to compensate for the playback time-based error. As the head drum speed deviations were detected, a signal representing these errors would be sent to the Amtec, and the video signal would be delayed as necessary to compensate for the instability. The Color Tech was later designed for less major errors to provide a stable color playback signal.
Up until now, we've been concentrating pretty much on an outdated videotape format, 2-inch quad. Why? Because the quad was the venerable workhorse of television videotape for the first 20 years. But there's more to it than that. A 2-inch VTR embodies all the principles used in modern helical scan machines that have taken over in the intervening 40 years, but in ways that are easy for all of us to see. Indeed, each component and section of a quad can be physically removed and studied further. By contrast, modern VTRs are often highly centralized marvels of construction. Often more than one subsystem will be on the single printed circuit board, or even within one integrated circuit chip.
Much has been said about the hands-on approach to learning about videotape technology. But in fact, so much of this background information is seldom used because of the comparable high reliability of today's equipment and the relative lack of operator adjustments. There are hardly any line of controls on the front panels of such equipment except input and output level controls and tracking adjustments. Even these are often placed in automatic or preset conditions. With this machine in mind, it's now time to leave nostalgia and history behind us and take a look at the formats and features available to us today.